Always choose to talk.
We ask the questions.
What is needed in the world?
Is that going to be?
On nije obični ekonomista. Jonas Ridderstrale je ekonomski guru, jedan od najutjecajnijih mislilaca i govornika iz svijeta biznisa. Ekstravagantan, humorističan i energičan, baš poput njegovih knjiga, funky biznis, karaoke, kapitalizam. Bio je jedan od najmlađih švedskih akademika, predaje na fakultetu u Velikoj Britaniji. A na listi njegovih klijenata nalaze se najpoznatije svjetske kompanije, vlade i sindikati. Ne uči ih kako voditi biznis, već kako da misle i budu inovativniji, da opstanu na tržištu okrutnog kapitalizma i konkurencije.
Mr. Ridderstrale, welcome to Al Jazeera.
Thank you.
Your book is Funky Business, and it was pronounced a 16th best book of all times. Is business funky, and what does it mean?
It means that business ought to be funky. It was written at a point in time, some 15 years ago, when business, I think in most parts of the world, was still seen as something very stiff, organizations led by people who sort of looked like me, in a suit and a tie, usually male, and things were beginning to happen. And I think we were really good at trying to capture the gist of a movement that basically meant that conventional business was doomed. Instead, in unconventional times, you needed unconventional business, innovative business, creative business, and we called it funky because if people expected business to be something, it certainly wasn't funky.
You talk about capitalism, but it has changed a lot during, let's say, last 20 years. How would you describe it today? In what shape it is? Healthy, fit, or it's dead?
I think a lot of people make the mistake of believing that capitalism is an ideology, like liberalism or socialism or communism. Capitalism isn't. Capitalism basically has nothing to tell us about how much money we should spend on healthcare or education. Capitalism, as I see it, is a machine. It is a machine that sorts the efficient from the inefficient. Now, what is so amazing about this machine is that you can feed it with just about anything. And I'm not suggesting that we should, but we could. You can put an artist like Lady Gaga into the machine. You can take a football player like Zlatan Ibrahimovic, put him into the machine. You can take a company like General Motors, a country like Greece, and the machine will tell you if it's efficient or not. Now, if you look at General Motors, if you look at Greece, organizations and countries that have had problems. If you say that there's something wrong with capitalism, you're basically saying Greece is actually a pretty darn good economy. There's nothing wrong with the Greek economy, and General Motors make really good cars. It's just that there's something wrong with the machine, because a GM car is better than a BMW car. Now, I've tried both. I think BMW make better cars than General Motors, and the German economy is in better shape than the Greek economy. So from that point of view, no, capitalism is alive and well. The machine seems to be working. Now, the problem is if we start using this principle all over the place, because I think there's a risk when you elevate those principles to almost religious stature that deadly sins like greed basically becomes a heavenly virtue. So there are limits to capitalism, and I think one danger is if we've built a machine that produces efficiency at the expense of sustainability. And with sustainability, I'm referring not only to economic sustainability, but also to environmental sustainability and personal sustainability. I mean, there are so many people who are feeling bad because of stress and work-life balance issues today.
Your other book is called Karaoke Capitalism. Why karaoke, and what does it take for one company to be successful and sustainable on today's market? Because, as you said, efficiency and quality are not enough anymore.
a karaoke club at the end of the day is a place for institutionalized imitation. You go there to be someone else. You pretend to be Elvis, or you pretend to be Madonna, or you pretend to be Frank Sinatra. And I think in the business world we have that too. It's called benchmarking. It's called taking an MBA program, because most MBA programs around the world are so similar. You read the very same books, you learn the very same models, and sameness at the end of the day will never ever lead to sustainable success. And in the business world, we also find a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy. Not the great companies, because they tend to divert, take their own route. And the argument we made in karaoke capitalism is that essentially you have to make a choice. Either you compete on fitness, having the best business model, being the most efficient company in your industry, or you compete on sex appeal. You use design, aesthetics, ethics, and you pick an emotional battle rather than a rational battle. The big challenge today is that in retrospect, we can all see what choices companies have made, and you don't need to be a genius to realize that Apple has been one of the sexiest companies in the world during the last 5 to 10 years, or that Dell for many years had the fittest business model.
Yes, but today when we look at their quarterly reports that are coming out now, we see that Apple, Microsoft, the banks, that their balance sheets are not so good, that they're missing profit targets. Does it mean that they're losing that talent that makes profit dance?
Really, in order to understand what is going on, one should look at the very basic principles of the market economy. The more competition we get, and the internet is great because it fuels competitiveness, the more competitive pressure that we see, the lower the profits we should expect. So there are so many technologies right now that are playing in the hands of you and me as customers. There are so many different ways in which we can exert pressure on companies to lower their prices. Then you have talent, and talent also wants their piece of the pie. If you look at organizations like Google, Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, of course, they're so heavily reliant on a few fantastically intelligent and talented people, but they can exert power. So if anything, the better the market works, the lower the profits we should expect.
Holy grail of business for you, it's a temporary monopoly. What do you mean by that?
A temporary monopoly is the short moment in time and or space during which you are perceived to be unique. And the little word perceived is actually important, because you don't have to be unique so long as you are perceived to be unique in the eyes of the customer. Now, why is that so important? Well, competitiveness is really about avoiding competitive pressure. If you leave the customer with very limited choice or no choice at all, if you revoke their freedom to choose, then you can make money. Otherwise, there will be this constant pressure, this constant war. Now, we picked the term temporary monopoly in Funky Business. Other management writers have called it a competitive advantage. Some have called it a blue ocean. A red ocean is characterized by sharks and everyone's fighting. And really, competitiveness, if you look at the word competition, means running alongside with. But if you're running alongside with, you will not be unique. So it's about choosing that different route, traveling down the road less traveled.
For success and for as a crucial differentiator for business, you also use a credible handicap. What is that?
Well, a credible handicap is a theory from evolutionary biology. Darwin had great difficulties explaining why the peacock was around. I mean, the peacock is certainly not fit. You can see the tail, it's huge. You don't need a PhD in biology to realize that he has certain problems hiding, he can't run, he can't fly. So he's meaningless from a fitness perspective, from a natural selection perspective. Now, why then do female, the peahen, why do females prefer this unfit guy with huge tails? Now, It was an Israeli biologist in the 1970s who proposed this theory called having a credible handicap. And the bigger the handicap you have, the more attractive you become. And the reasoning is that the peahen says, if you can survive, given all that, you must have absolutely amazing genes, because you should be dead, someone should have caught you, someone should have killed you. Now, what does this mean in the business world? Well, it basically means that if you can spend a lot of time and effort and money on design, on building a beautiful car or a beautiful cell phone, the customer will say, well, if you could do that, all the other stuff must be absolutely amazing, because in addition to all that, you could spend all that extra time and effort on design, on aesthetics, or on ethics, whatever it may be.
You say that companies should become a breeding ground for risk takers. But didn't that risk overtake, let's call it like that, bring us in the position where we are today? I mean, with the financial crisis that occurred, the fall of Lehman Brothers, banks who pay $1 billion fines for cheating and taking too much risk.
Well, let me elaborate a little bit on it. I'm not saying that we should build organizations that necessarily take more risk. I'm merely proposing that if you want innovation, if you want creativity, if you want new stuff, if you want to be a disruptor of your industry, you must make it less risky for people to take risk. Now, sometimes we want a lot of risk taking, other times we want less risk taking. If you're running a nuclear plant, I would prefer someone who takes less risk rather than a lot of risk. If you're running a bank, a financial institution, I would also prefer someone, at least on a general level, on a systems level, who takes limited risk rather than all the risk in the world. And the argument that I made here at the conference where I was invited by the GI Group in Belgrade was that if you look at men versus women, we know that women in general take less risk than men. Why then do we see so few highly sensitive systems, economic systems, social systems, where women are in charge? Now, the trend is clear, things are changing. The argument I made here today was that if Lehman Brothers had been managed by Lehman Sisters, maybe we could have avoided some of the problems that the Western world at least is still struggling with from a financial point of view.
You said that for competitiveness, in order to have it, new companies should break rules in order to make new rules. And is this what we see today with the car industry, that is completely breaking the rules, falsifying data and everything in order to have that profit, to have more sales, in order to survive, because they are scared of what is coming?
I mean, I don't know the specifics of the example that you are referring to, which of course is Volkswagen. And we don't even know if Volkswagen is the only company. In all likelihood, a few other companies have also had their fingers in in this cookie jar. I mean, one obvious thing, if you look at Volkswagen, was that they basically changed their dream, their vision, into becoming the biggest car company in the world. And I think if you're chasing that, becoming the biggest, there's a tendency, if you go for size rather than quality or something along those lines, that you become tempted to start tweaking things a little bit, and then a little bit more, and then a little bit more. But again, I don't know the specifics of Volkswagen. What we do know is that lack of character is something that is so critical in business today, because reputation, it said, arrives on foot but leaves on horseback, and it's so difficult to deal with reputational risk in today's economy, because I think all leaders today should be aware of the fact that even when you're in the Hall of Fame, right next door there is the Hall of Shame.
What is the biggest difference between running a country and a company?
You can't fire your employees if you're running a country. You can make it less attractive for them to stay. Also, a country, most of them at least, are democracies. If you don't do a good job and you're evaluated from below, you will be kicked out. We should remember that most business organizations are more dictatorships. You're elected from the top, from the owners, and then you can dictate, at least on paper, what goes on. So I would argue that it's more difficult to run a country than a company.
But if we, let's say, compare European Union with a company, some of its parts are struggling to survive, as Greece, as you said it, and the others are trying to find a way out, as UK, with the possible Brexit. Will EU survive this?
Well, the future is a little bit like death. No one has ever come back with a completely reliable report. So I think one should be very, very careful about making predictions about the future. I think one of the, to me, there are a couple of main issues that the European Union is struggling with. One is that we still tend to define Europe as a geographical entity. There is no Eurovision. Now we're having the Eurovision Song Contest in Stockholm, where I live, the upcoming weekend here. Fine, I don't have anything against that. It's not my kind of music. But what we really need is a vision for Europe. And that European dream needs to be fundamentally different from the American dream, because otherwise we become a karaoke copy of the United States of America. I see so little of that right now. And maybe it's because we're in a situation where we cannot really raise our heads and gaze into the future. We're sort of constantly focusing on the now kind of things. That's one worry I have. The second worry is building a currency union with the euro, I think, was premature. There are two big differences within Europe for that to work. Maybe we could have had a northern European currency zone with Germany, Benelux, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, possibly. The UK, you never know. Why was it premature? Well, with those differences, you need an oil in the machinery that can compensate for the fact that the differences are so big. If you look at the US, that oil is the English language. You can easily have people move from Georgia or Alabama to New York or to Washington, because people will have to move to the places where it's easy to find a job. We don't see enough of that in Europe, because there's a lack of this lowest common denominator, which tends to be the language.
When we speak about economic growth, is the biggest issue of this, let's say, 7-8 years with the financial crisis. How we power up again our machines? How do we go out, because crises keep on coming?
Well, yes and no, because if you look at the world economy, there are still quite a few economies that are doing pretty darn well. I mean, you still find high growth numbers in some of the European economies. You still find high growth numbers in many of the Asian economies. Africa, it's a wonder. I mean, many people have had given up hope about what was going on in Africa. So we still see growth on an overall global level. It's going to be the same thing that always fuels economic growth: technological change, innovation, the kind of developments that we're going to see in fields like biotech, nanotechnology, and still in information technology over the next 10 to 15 years, I'm pretty sure will fuel a lot of growth. I mean, we've moved from a situation in which power and education was basically a male Western thing, to a world in which power and education is now a male-female, bordering on becoming more of a female thing than a male thing, and it's no longer only a Western phenomenon. We see it all over the place. So we have a world with maybe 6 billion people who are doing interesting work, thinking about interesting things, and it used to be one. And of course, 6 billion people thinking creatively about the future will come up with better solutions than if you only have 1 billion. So I'm optimistic about the future. The world was not a better place 25 years ago, and the world I'm betting on will be an even better place in 25 years than it is right now.
We gained a lot of freedom since then, with internet, globalization and everything. We have so much choices today. But are there our curse or a blessing? Are they making us more secure or uncertain?
both. I think it was Sartre, the French philosopher, who once said that we're all condemned to freedom, the freedom to constantly have to choose. Freedom without education is scary. It's like in a lot of companies that went through this wave of decentralization during the 1980s and 90s, if you didn't educate your employees, the end result was chaos, because they ended up with so much responsibility in their own laps, but they lacked the proper tools for dealing with it. And I think the same is true if you look at this deregulation of life and the deregulation of the economy that we've seen on a societal level over the last 25 years. If you don't train and educate people, they're going to be bewildered, sometimes scared, and many of them will say no. And that's what we're seeing now in many places in the world. People saying no, no to globalization, no to urbanization, no to women, no to so many of the things that I enjoy about this new world.
If we look this region here, we're in a process of transition for, let's say, last 26 years. How do we go out from this never-ending stage? I mean, can we take some advice from Sweden, Scandinavian countries that are so successful in everything they do?
I think there are a couple of reasons, because I think a lot of people in Europe are betting on size being the big thing that will save us. If we could only create these large pan-European projects, things would change. Look at the most successful economies in Europe right now. With the exception of Germany, they're small, they are open. There are places like Sweden, places like Switzerland, places like Holland. What have we done? Well, quite early on, we did educational reforms. That was critical. Sweden was one of the poorest countries in Europe if you go back 125 years. So that's number one. Number two, to create equal opportunity for women. We're not perfect, but we're probably among the least imperfect economies in the world. So that has been critical. Make sure that both genders stand a genuine chance of making it. Number three, go international. Look outside. Learn to speak English, learn to speak German, learn to speak French. Because for most European countries, especially small ones like Sweden and Serbia, the rest of the world is like most of it, almost all of it. If you're an American company, it can probably be marginal. So go out there and understand that there are reasons for why we have two ears and one mouth. Listen. And try to combine signals from different parts of the world. So I think there are some things in our recipe that could easily be attributed to some of it to our culture, some of it to the way in which we organize things that could be applied also in a Serbian setting.
What would you say to our leaders to do?
Well, you have quite a few ambassadors throughout Europe, because you've sent people out. I mean, ex-Yugoslavia and then Serbia and Croatia and Bosnia. I mean, in my home country, I mean, half of all the really good soccer players are ex-Yugoslavians, because we've had this wave of people from this part of the world coming to Sweden since the 1950s and 60s. And maybe that's a way out, to use all those ambassadors. But in general, I don't think there's this magical dust that you can sprinkle on the situation. It's a lot of hard work, but it's about being out there, not giving up, being persistent, and also about not going out with everything you have. You must take your hits. So the single rather than the album, to use an old metaphor that wouldn't work with young people, because they don't know the difference between a single and an album anymore.
When you speak about people, you said that we're all Homer Simpson, that we're becoming incredibly stupid. Why?
I said we're becoming increasingly stupid, and it boils down to the simple fact that knowledge on the societal level, what we know as mankind, is growing at an exponential rate. All the books, all the gurus, all the stuff you find on the internet is growing at a rate that we've never ever seen before. Whereas individual knowledge is growing at a much slower rate. So there is this gap between what I know and what we know, which basically means that even the smartest of the smartest cannot control more than a very small fraction of all the knowledge within their own field. And the implications are obvious for companies, for individuals, for countries. We need to collaborate. We need to team up. We need to find partners. We need to cooperate. So if the old principle within an economy was about competition, maybe the new principle should be more about collaboration and cooperation.
When you speak about knowledge, the talent, will that be a new battlefield between the countries and companies? Because let's say we go to universities, get the same education, but we have something that has to put us up, and it's talent. Will it be a new battlefield?
I think it already is. And I think historically the United States of America has been really good at mopping up all the talent, no matter where in the world people were born. If you take a look at so many of the startup companies in the US founded by people who weren't born in the United States, Sergey Brin of Google doesn't sound very American. It's not like Adam Smith or John Taylor. So if you look at company after company, I mean, immigration and this inflow of talent to the United States has been so critical for keeping the American economic machine alive and well.
Thank you very much for this interview.
Thank you.